In the last few years, the world has gone from one earth-shaking crisis to another. While some say that we are on the threshold of a brave new world order, others warn that humanity now totters on the brink of unprecedented disaster and chaos. Reading the news nowadays is not the most cheerful way to start the day. Day by day, the world's problems grow more desperate and insurmountable. The question which plagues every thinking person is, what lies ahead? But has any mortal man ever been able to transcend the bounds of time and peer into the future? Throughout history, there have been many who have claimed such powers, and some, like Nostradamus, the Fatima children, Edgar Casey, and Jean Dixon are widely accepted as having predicted various future events. And the world stage is now set for the fulfillment of one awesome vision which many of these seers had in common, an event so cataclysmic that it will change the world as we now know it forever. The final apocalypse, Armageddon. But if you really want to know the future, exactly what's going to happen, why, and even when, then you must turn to the thousands of prophecies recorded in this book, the Bible. History has proven the extraordinary, unerring accuracy of Bible prophecy. And therefore, there can be no doubt that its hundreds of prophecies about the last days of our planet Earth will also be fulfilled just as surely as the ones that have already been fulfilled in the past. The only question is, when? Sometime in the far future that we don't need to worry about now? Or are we in fact now standing on the threshold of these final, great, and climactic events of which all the Bible prophets, including Jesus, spoke? 2,000 years ago, Jesus' disciples sought answers to this same question. They asked him, "Tell us, what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world?" Let's take a look at some of the signs of the end that Jesus himself warned us to be on the lookout for.
"And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars, for nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom."
No period has witnessed the escalation of wars as did the last century. Over 110 million people were killed in wars just in the 20th century. That's three times more than died in wars in the 18 preceding centuries combined. Up until 1914, war had never been universal. But in both World War I and II, total war was waged. Since World War II, the war that was supposed to make the world safe for democracy, there have been over 130 major wars and hundreds of smaller armed conflicts in which more than 23 million people have been killed directly and another 20 million through famine and other war-related calamities. November 89. The opening of the Berlin Wall symbolizes the end of the Cold War between the superpowers. But instead of the expected peace, more wars and rumors of wars raged around our planet.
As of 2007, 34 armed conflicts were being waged around the world. Nation rising against nation and kingdom against kingdom could more accurately be translated as ethnic group rising against ethnic group, a prophecy dreadfully fulfilled in the former Yugoslavia, Rwanda, Congo, and other trouble spots around the world. Not only are wars and rumors of wars on the increase, but also the horrors that wars unleash.
We have become numb to news of atrocities and tortures, mass rape and murder, which show what horrible savagery modern man is still capable of when he is unrestrained by God. Nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines.
Former U.S. President General Dwight D. Eisenhower put the true cost of war in simple terms when he said, "Every gun that is made, every warship launched, every rocket fired is, in a sense, a theft from those who hunger and are not fed, those who are cold and are not clothed." The war in Iraq cost the U.S. approximately $430 billion in the first 4 years. An F-35B fighter costs around $62 million. A Westland WAH-64 Apache attack helicopter costs $46.2 million. An Abrams M1A2 battle tank costs $5.6 million. A Tomahawk missile, about $1.3 million. Researchers say each minute of the U.S. war on Iraq costs $380,000. According to the World Food Program, 20,000 children die of hunger every day, but that 19 U.S. cents can feed a child a meal. There are approximately 400 million chronically hungry children in the world. The amount spent on the Iraq War from 2003 to 2007 could have fed them all for nearly 10 years. The World Health Organization estimates that one-third of the world is well-fed, one-third is underfed, one-third is starving. Since you started watching this program, at least 300 people have died of starvation. Over 7 million will die of hunger this year. However, the world can produce enough food to feed its expanding population. While some famines are caused by drought or other so-called natural disasters, these children are more likely to be starving because of man's inhumanity to man. War, embargoes, government corruption, and economic oppression, such as the insurmountable debt many developing countries owe to international creditors, who now hold the debtor nations in economic slavery, extracting exorbitant interest rates that ensure that the poor grow poorer and the rich lenders grow richer. Famines are largely a result of man's corruption and greed and unwillingness to care for others.
And there shall be famines and pestilences.
In 2007, over 2 million people died of AIDS. Another 2.5 million became infected with HIV, the virus that causes AIDS. So far, it is estimated that 25 million people have died from AIDS since 1981, and another 33 million are living with HIV/AIDS. However, AIDS is not the only modern plague to afflict mankind. Each year, over 10 million people are diagnosed with cancer. There are around 200 forms of cancer, and it kills 6 million people annually. War and poverty have devastated the healthcare systems of many countries, and diseases once thought banished by modern science have made an alarming comeback. Epidemics of typhoid, diphtheria, and even the Black Death have afflicted areas of India, Africa, Russia, and other countries of the former Soviet Union. Deadly new strains of malaria, tuberculosis, and cholera are becoming resistant to all known antibiotics and are killing millions of people, along with hospital superbugs that are causing a crisis in healthcare worldwide.
Even the common bacteria that causes pneumonia, children's ear infections, and many other everyday diseases have developed resistance to modern medicine and are evolving into untreatable forms, threatening a chilling post-antibiotic era where even the simplest infections could quickly escalate into fatal diseases. One of the biggest concerns to epidemiologists, the medical professionals who study epidemics, is that an influenza pandemic similar to the one in 1918 that killed an estimated 50 million people is overdue to strike.
There shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in various places.
At 8 in the morning on December the 26, 2004, a magnitude 9.3 earthquake ripped apart the seafloor off the northwest coast of the Indonesian island of Sumatra. The second biggest earthquake in recorded history unleashed a devastating tsunami that traveled thousands of kilometers across the Indian Ocean, taking the lives of nearly 300,000 people on the coastal regions of Indonesia, Thailand, Malaysia, India, Sri Lanka, and even Eastern Africa. It was followed less than 3 months later by another great quake measuring 8.7 in the same region. It was the first time in recorded seismic history, more than a century, that two quakes of such size have happened so close together. The Bible predicts that the last days will be a time of great seismic activity, with the earth reeling to and fro like a drunken man, and the towers and the cities of the nations falling.
January the 17th, 1994, an earthquake measuring 6.6 on the Richter scale causes $30 billion worth of damage in Los Angeles. Seismologists predict that California's imminent big one could be 50 times more powerful. January the 17th, 1995, over 5,000 people are killed and 26,000 injured in the Great Hanshin quake in Japan. The port city of Kobe is devastated. Its infrastructure destroyed, and over 300,000 people made homeless. Japanese scientists at the Earthquake Center in Tsukuba predict a much stronger quake measuring over 8 on the Richter scale could hit the Tokyo area in the very near future. When either the California or the Tokyo quakes inevitably occur, the death toll, the devastation, as well as the impact on the world economy will be unimaginable.
Imagine an ancient prophet seeing a vision of our modern superhighways with hundreds of cars speeding along with their headlights blazing at night. How would he describe it? Now remember, he'd never seen or even imagined anything like an automobile before. Well, 2,600 years ago, the prophet Nahum foresaw that in the last days before Jesus returns,
the chariots shall rage in the streets. They shall jostle one against another in the broadways. They shall seem like torches. They shall run like the lightnings.
Automobiles racing along in the night must have looked like lightning to him. And they certainly do jostle one another in the broad ways.
Since the invention of the motor vehicle over a century ago, it is estimated that about 30 million people have been killed in road crashes. Globally, an estimated 1.2 million people are killed in road accidents each year, and as many as 50 million are injured.
Nahum's prophecy brings to mind another important prediction regarding conditions in the last days, given in 534 BC to the prophet Daniel.
Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book, even to the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased.
God was telling his prophet, Daniel, I'm giving this vision of the last days to you, but it's not for you. It's not for your time. It's for the end time, when
many shall run to and fro.
Are many people running to and fro today? It's incredible when you think that people's primary means of travel hadn't changed for thousands of years until just a little over a century ago. In 1789, it took George Washington 8 days to travel 200 miles to his inauguration in New York City. What is amazing is that Julius Caesar could have also made the trip in 8 days. No real progress had been made in transportation over thousands of years. But in the last 100 years, a relative blip in overall human history, look how travel has advanced. Now, man not only drives at enormous speeds, but a new generation of supersonic private jets will fly at nearly 2,000 kilometers per hour, and the space shuttle orbits the Earth in 90 minutes. People travel today more than they ever traveled before. According to the Geneva-based Airports Council International, airlines carried 2.16 billion passengers in the 12-month period ending June 2006, equivalent to about 1 in 3 of the world's population. World travel and tourism generated in excess of $7 trillion in 2007 and is expected to generate $13 trillion a year over the coming decade. The tourism industry is the largest in the world today, responsible for employing more than 230 million people worldwide and generating over 10% of the global GDP.
Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased.
It is difficult to measure knowledge, but one yardstick we can go by is available information. The world produces unique information that is roughly equivalent to the textual content of 1.2 billion books per year. 70% of all information in our global society has been created since the beginnings of the internet in the early 70s and is currently doubling every 3 years. In 1970, when Apollo 13 was lost in space, computers worked out in 90 minutes a way to bring it back. It would have taken a scientist working with a pencil and paper over 1 million years to figure out how to do the same feat. Since 1970, computer technology has developed so fast that if the auto industry had developed at the same rate, you would today be able to buy a Rolls-Royce for $3, and you could fit 8 of them on the head of a pin. There are now wristwatches that wield more computing ability than some 1970s mainframes. Ordinary cars today have more intelligence than the original Apollo lunar module.
But have all these amazing scientific discoveries and technological breakthroughs made mankind any happier or more civilized? It seems like the more gadgets and luxuries with which man tries to find happiness and satisfaction, the more discontented and miserable he becomes.
The 178 nation Happy Planet Index, published by the New Economics Foundation in July 2006, lists the South Pacific island of Vanuatu as the happiest nation on the planet. Meanwhile, Western nations with their high level of prosperity and abundance are way down the list. For instance, the UK and the USA fill 108th and 150th places, respectively. Depression is now the fourth leading cause of the global disease burden and the leading cause of disability worldwide. Depression is the most important risk factor for suicide, which claims around 1 million lives annually, with another 10 to 20 million attempting suicide each year, and is among the top 3 causes of death in young people ages 15 to 35.
Also in Matthew chapter 24 and verse 37, Jesus prophesied that as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days just before he returns. Well, how were things in the days of Noah?
And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. The earth also was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with violence.
In the US, a young man goes on a shooting rampage at his university, murdering 32 of his schoolmates and teachers and injuring 15 others. In Britain, 2 10-year-old boys kidnap and brutally murder a toddler. In today's world, such horror is becoming commonplace. It is hard to imagine that even the days of Noah were as violence-filled as those in which we are now living. Political violence is the term used to describe the violence perpetrated by governments or political and ideological groups. In the 20th century, it is estimated that around 110 million people died as a result of wars. However, this pales in comparison to the 170 million people estimated to have been killed in political violence, which translates into around 4,600 people being killed every day for 100 years. That is the equivalent of nearly two 9/11 attacks occurring every day for the last 100 years. Each year, more than 1.6 million people worldwide lose their lives to violence that is not war or politically related. For everyone who dies as a result of violence, many more are injured and suffer from a range of physical, sexual, reproductive, and mental health problems. Violence is among the leading causes of death for people aged 15 to 44 worldwide. Much of this violence occurs in the developing world, but violence is endemic in developed nations as well. In the US, 651,697 people died from gun-related killings in the 19 years spanning 1979 to 1997. That is more than all the US military personnel who died in combat in all wars going back to the start of the American Revolutionary War in 1775 through to the end of the 20th century. Aside from the very real violence that fills so much of our world, violence is also a mainstay of the entertainment industry. By the time the average American child is 18 years old, he will witness 16,000 murders on television, as well as 200,000 other acts of violence. The level of violence during Saturday morning cartoons is much higher than the level of violence during primetime. Primetime shows have an average of 3 to 5 acts of violence per hour, whereas the level is 20 to 25 acts of violence per hour for the cartoons. On average, 75% of violence seen on TV shows features no immediate punishment or condemnation. Although Hollywood and the US media industry are not the only producers of violent output, US TV programs are popular around the world, and almost 80% of movies sold overseas come from the US movie industry. Violence is also glorified in the burgeoning $45 billion video game industry. 89% of computer games contain violence, of which over half is of a serious nature. Music videos, the heavy metal and gangster rap genres in particular, are also violence-filled. Assault, rape, sadism, suicide, racism, and murder are familiar ingredients of music videos, with the perpetrators often depicted as the good guys. Once relegated to the fringes, gangster rap, filled with profanity and hate, has become a cash cow for the mainstream music industry. Whether violence in the media spills over into violence in society or vice versa is a contentious issue, but it cannot be denied that just as in the days of Noah, the earth is filled with violence.
The only comfort in this terrible tide of rising violence is that, according to Bible prophecy, it is yet another unquestionable sign that points to the second coming of Jesus Christ, when all senseless violence and cruelty will be stopped and war itself will be abolished.
And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall grow cold.
This prophecy by Jesus about the end times certainly is being fulfilled. And no one can deny that the love between so many people has certainly grown cold. As family and social ties succumb to the pressures of modern living, every country in the developed world reports steady increases in the number of people living alone. Social scientists say loneliness is more common today than ever before in history and have called it an epidemic.
Another scripture in 2 Timothy says that in the last days, mankind would be without natural affection. In the Old Testament times, some pagan nations were also without natural affection, so much so that it was common practice for mothers to do what the Bible describes as cause their children to pass through the fire.
This was referring to their practice of offering up their babies to the devil god Moloch, a huge idol which had movable arms hinged at the elbows and a big yawning mouth with a roaring fire inside. It was their method of selfishly getting rid of unwanted babies.
Today's methods in our enlightened modern generation are no less shameful and horrific. Despite the fact that advances in fetal science have made a compelling case that human life begins at conception, worldwide an estimated 46 million unborn children's lives are snuffed out every year.
God's word says,
"In thy skirts is found the blood of the souls of the poor innocents. I have not found it by secret search, but upon all these."
Researchers have documented that from 1920 to 2005, there were 757 million reported abortions performed. Taking into account estimates of unreported abortions, the total is projected to be 945 million abortions in that 85-year period. Worldwide, the lifetime average is about one abortion per woman. This is an indictment of modern society, the conditions and values of which push women into making such a decision.
Concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to Him, let no one deceive you by any mean, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first.
Europe today has been described as a post-Christian culture where religion plays very little part. Many other Western nations also have become increasingly secularized. While interest in traditional Christianity has declined, interest in alternative spiritualities, including the occult, has grown considerably. For instance, it is estimated that there are as many as 700,000 professing witches or pagans in the United States, and there are millions worldwide who dabble in some form of the occult.
Witchcraft today is no longer the stuff of small underground cults. Many rock videos are an open worship of Satan and hell that comes complete with the symbols, liturgies, and rituals of witchcraft. And millions of young people have been caught in its evil sway. These sounds of horror and torment are literally driving young people insane and seducing them into a life of drugs, suicide, perversion, and hell.
Today, even the most shameless acts of blasphemy and desecration are socially acceptable. In the book of Revelation, the Apostle John foresaw that in the last days the world would turn away from God in order to worship and follow Satan. Such a prophecy would have seemed unbelievable to previous generations, but not so in our day. Hardcore Satanism has been called the fastest growing subculture among Western teens. And the revival of paganism and the occult is one of the world's fastest growing religions.
After telling his disciples that some of these signs that you've just seen, wars, famines, plagues, and earthquakes, were just the beginning of sorrows, Jesus went on to foretell a sign that would signify when the actual time of the end had arrived.
"And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come."
Those who study the impact of Christian missionary work estimate that between 75 and 85% of the world's population have heard the gospel at least once. Every year, about 4 billion gospel tracts are distributed around the globe, along with over 150 million Bibles. The entire Bible, or portions of it, have now been translated into some 2,300 different languages and is available to around 98% of the world's population. The gospel is also preached from over 4,000 radio and television stations. 99% of the world's population have the gospel available to them via Christian radio stations. Meanwhile, an innumerable number of Christian websites, cyber churches, internet radio stations, and other Christian ministries evangelize, inform, and pastor via the internet. And then there is the Jesus film. Shot on location in the Holy Land in 1979, it is a retelling of Luke's Gospel. Starring a white, British Jesus, and with mostly Yemenite Jews in the cast, it is an unlikely candidate for the title of the most watched and most translated film. Yet it is now translated into 944 languages, with over 200 more translations in progress. It has had an estimated combined audience to date of around 5.5 billion. Never in the entire course of history has the gospel been preached in all the world to all nations as it is right now. Every nation on the face of the earth today has heard the gospel as Jesus prophesied they would before the end comes. So, if Jesus was right and the Bible is true, we are now living in the time of the end.
In the beginning of Matthew chapter 16, Jesus' religious enemies challenged him to show them a sign from heaven. He answered and said to them, "When it is evening, ye say, 'It'll be fair weather tomorrow, for the sky is red.' And in the morning, ye say, 'It'll be foul weather today, for the sky is red and threatening.' Ye hypocrites, ye can discern the face of the sky, but can ye not discern the signs of the times?" Modern technology has vastly improved our ability to forecast the weather. But are we any less blind to the ominous signs of the times in which we are now living?
"So likewise ye, when ye see these things come to pass, know ye that the kingdom of God is nigh at hand. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass away till all be fulfilled."
So what is yet to come to pass? Well, one of the final signs of the very end is the rise of a one-world government headed by a superhuman dictator. The Antichrist.
The Antichrist, also described in the Bible as the son of perdition and the beast. Like Hitler, who was one of history's Antichrist archetypes, he will have great charisma and speaking ability, a mouth speaking great things.
Who would not welcome a solution to the desperate economic, military, and political problems besetting humanity? This master of negotiation will enter the world stage with a brilliant 7-year plan for world peace, economic stability, and religious freedom. The Antichrist could well rise out of the former Soviet Union. Daniel saw him arising from somewhere out of Alexander the Great's old empire, which spanned from Greece in the west to Pakistan in the east, and from Egypt in the south to the borders of Russia in the north. The prophet Ezekiel names him as the ruler of Magog, a name that biblical scholars agree denotes a country or region of peoples to the north of Israel. Many have interpreted this to mean modern-day Russia. Visions recorded in the book of Daniel indicate that the Antichrist will be associated with 10 kings of nations that were once part of the Roman Empire, which included much of Western and Southern Europe. The book of Revelation says these 10 will give their power and strength unto the beast. The Bible even gives some clues about his personal characteristics. The prophet Daniel wrote that the Antichrist does not regard the desire of women. This could imply that he is either celibate or a homosexual. Daniel also tells us that he will have a fierce countenance or stern look and will be more stout than his fellows, more proud and boastful. The 7-year peace pact or covenant that is engineered by the Antichrist is spoken of a number of times in the Bible. Under the final terms of the covenant, Jerusalem would likely be declared an international city. which is in fact a reversion to Jerusalem's original status in the UN partition plan of 1947, Part 3, which created the State of Israel, to which Judaism, Islam, and Christianity will have equal rights. Scripture indicates that the Jews will be permitted to rebuild their temple on Mount Moriah, where they revive their ancient rituals of animal sacrifice. Despite his world domination, the Antichrist regime will meet with serious resistance. Daniel describes several major wars that the Antichrist fights during his seven-year reign against those who will oppose him. For a while, most of the world is going to think the Antichrist is wonderful, as he will have seemed to have solved so many of the world's problems. But 3.5 years into his seven-year reign, he will break the covenant and invade Israel.
At this time, he makes Jerusalem his world capital and outlaws all religions except for the worship of himself and his image. The Bible says that the Antichrist will sit in the Jewish temple, exalting himself as God and demanding to be worshipped.
The Antichrist government will then also impose the infamous 666 cashless monetary system.
And he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, and that no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name. And his number is 666.
666, the mark of the beast. Almost everybody has heard something about this prophecy that says that in the last days, no one will be able to buy or sell anything unless they get the devil's mark. Well, today, we're the first generation with the technology available to fulfill such a prophecy of a cashless society. At present, in this supermarket, there are just three ways in which I can pay for this shopping. I can use cash, or I can write a check, or I can pay by credit card.
Debit and credit cards are now widely used in many parts of the world. Then there's the smart card, which has a microprocessor embedded in it and is becoming the industry standard for debit and credit cards. Besides financial transactions, smart cards can also be used as driving licenses, identity cards, passports, and to hold medical data. More recent smart cards use RFID wireless technology so they can be used when in proximity of a terminal. And then there's completely electronic online commerce, which is fast becoming the primary way for many businesses and consumers to buy and sell. So you can see we are fast on the way to eliminating cash, and there are many compelling reasons why. Cash is the very mother's milk of drug smugglers, who often deal in cash a suitcase full at a time. With no cash, the sale of illegal drugs would cease. In fact, to eliminate cash would eliminate many kinds of criminal activity, from theft to terrorism, and be an instant cure-all for many of the world's most desperate social and economic ills. No wonder governments are pushing towards the cashless society with unrestrained enthusiasm. But even with electronic commerce, there is the problem of identity theft. If crooks get a hold of your credit card numbers and rack up bills and debts in your name, they can ruin you financially. For a truly cashless society to function, this type of fraud needs to be eliminated.
However, before cash, checks, and credit cards can be phased out completely, thank you, they have to develop an identification system that is absolutely foolproof and will ensure that a person presenting a card for a transaction is actually the owner of that card. What if you took the chip out of the card and placed it under the skin? Once the chip has been implanted, it can be read by an inexpensive scanner, much like the one at your local grocery store. So you now become your own smart card. And the very expensive problem of making sure that the owner of the card is who he says he is has been solved.
In fact, the chip can be small because it's not necessary for all your data to be stored on it. Only a unique identifier, such as a number sequence, All your data would be stored in gigantic networked databases, and the number would access it. Stuff of the future? No, it has already happened. The chipping of people quietly began rolling out in the US via Applied Digital Solutions VeriChip. In May 2002, the historic chipping of the Jacobs family took place. This family and several other volunteers had a unique identifier injected under their skin. The chip, about the size of the tip of a ballpoint pen, can be read by a handheld VeriChip scanner. The Jacobs family suffers from various ailments, and the storage of their medical history provided the logic behind their volunteering to be the test cases. Clubs, schools, hospitals, and government departments around the world are now using these chips to identify people and allow them access to their facilities. And in some cases, it allows the bearer to make financial transactions. Radio frequency ID, RFID chips, are now commonly attached to merchandise which can theoretically be tracked, even after purchase. These same type of chips are now being installed in passports, meaning that their information can be read even without you taking yours out of your pocket. So as we can see, the technology and the public acceptance to make the Antichrist's 666 system work is rapidly falling into place. We have heard a lot about the New World Order, or global community, and these concepts are becoming a reality as the world heads towards a uniform economic system, a cashless society controlled by a networked computer system that spans the entire globe. Once a chipping system is implemented, surreptitious computer surveillance could keep track of every man, woman, and child, when and where they go, and when and what they buy and sell. Exactly as predicted in Revelation chapter 13, nearly 2,000 years ago.
If any man worship the beast and his image, and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture, and the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever.
The book of Revelation states six times that worshiping the beast and receiving his mark leads to damnation. There is a definite link between the two, though at this point in time it is not clear exactly what that will be. At first glance, it would seem that the mark is simply an economic and identification system, but from what the scriptures indicate, it leads to much more. Beware.
And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed.
This image of the beast, also described in Bible prophecy as the abomination of desolation, is some kind of incredibly high-tech representation of the Antichrist and his power at the core of his government structure. Scripture says it will speak and somehow cause those who refuse to worship it to be killed. Jesus said that when you see this image standing in the holy place, then shall be great tribulation such as the world has never known. A good part of the book of Revelation describes in horrific detail the terrible pestilences, plagues, and nightmarish monsters that God lets loose to tribulate the Antichrist forces who are trying to wipe out all who refuse to take the mark of the beast. The Bible spells out in years, months and days exactly how long this period of great tribulation will be. 3.5 years, or 42 months, or 1,260 days. The good news is that this great tribulation period is immediately followed by Christ's return. So on the day that the Antichrist breaks the covenant and sets up his image in Jerusalem, the countdown of the exact number of days until the second coming of Jesus Christ will begin.
Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens shall be shaken. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, And then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn. And they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet. And they shall gather together his chosen from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other.
The world's darkest period of tribulation and horror under the Antichrist will abruptly end with the dawning of the brightest dawn, as Jesus Christ himself returns to gather his children to be with him. Light, trumpets, thunder, earthquakes, and gigantic meteor showers will all herald this climactic event. God's children who have died throughout the ages will be resurrected in new miraculous bodies and will burst forth from their graves and ascend to meet Jesus in the air. Live Christians will be transformed and will rise from the earth, floating right up through ceilings and buildings and cars and right up into the clouds to meet the Lord. Such is the scenario depicted in the Bible of the second coming of Christ as he snatches his children out of reach of their evil Antichrist persecutors and whisks them away to the grandest, most glorious, and thrilling victory celebration that's ever been held, the great marriage supper of the Lamb in heaven. Meanwhile, down on earth, the horrible wrath of God is being poured out upon the Antichrist forces left behind. A time so terrible that the Bible says that men will seek death but be unable to find it. Then, shortly after Jesus' second coming, down from the sky will come the great hosts of heaven with Jesus in the lead to destroy the Antichrist and his one world empire in the awesome Battle of Armageddon. This great slaughter of the Antichrist and his armies will take place in and around the Valley of Megiddo in northern Israel and all the way to Jerusalem. It will mark the end of man's cruel rule on earth, as Jesus, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and his heavenly forces forcibly take over the world to rule and reign and run it the way it should have been run if man had not disobeyed God and gone his own selfish way. And so begins a period known as the millennium, 1,000 years of peace and plenty on a greatly restored and improved earth.
Well, to say the least, we're living in very exciting times, and there's soon to be some great global changes made. The curtains have been drawn aside on the last great scene of Earth's drama. The act has begun, and it cannot stop now. Like it or not, each one of our lives are going to be caught up in these great events. The countdown to Armageddon has begun.
The interpretations of these Bible prophecies which we have examined are not unique, but all or parts are shared by millions of Christians worldwide, Catholic, Protestant, and Orthodox. Many Muslims also believe that passages of the Quran and other Islamic writings foretell a number of these same apocalyptic events. One of the purposes of end-time Bible prophecy is to let you know what's going to happen in the future, so that you won't be taken by surprise by these great events, so you can rest assured that it is all a part of God's preordained plan. The best way to be prepared for the future is to receive Jesus as your Savior, as he has promised to be with his children to protect and provide for them and be their guide through perilous times. Jesus will give you the strength and courage to bravely face these future troubles and help you survive until the end of this world, after which he will reward you beyond your wildest dreams in the heavenly world to come. If you don't yet know Jesus, then we'd like to invite you right now to receive his free gift of everlasting life by repeating this simple prayer after me.
Dear Jesus, please come into my heart. Forgive me for my past mistakes and sins, and give me your free gift of everlasting life. Help me to love you, and help me to share your love and truth with others. Amen. There's only one life. It will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. Jesus said that we must work the works of him that sent us while it is day, for the night cometh when no man can work. Please work with us and help us in any way that you can to tell the world of God's love and to help others through these difficult times and show them what a wonderful world it's going to be.